thanks for coming for this third Agôn, Arts Agôn. And just in case you wonder where on earth we got that title, that's my fault. So I don't know, well, I'm sure you know that the Agôn was always the that space, which is a marketplace, but also the space of dispute and argument in the ancient polis. And it's also used a lot these days in issues of politics, agonism against antagonism, but also it happens to be something which I really like using myself in terms of the context of how the arts produce, or within education, but also within institutions and outside institutions, they produce this kind of agon of learning and agon of argument and unlearning. So that's where we decided to use the term. And this is the third one. We do one every semester, and it's I think it's been kind of, you know, gradually gaining momentum. With a lot of participants from different colleagues presenting. But this year we have an oddity, if you like, and I hope we can kind of keep the tradition, a new tradition, and that we have also international colleagues, colleagues coming from the University of Porto, the Faculty of Fine Art, together with our own Liz, who is also the Sinaiko Frank winner in 2017. Hey! So, without further ado, I was asked today, actually, to try to explain what the hell is arts research, and this is a big question which we keep doing, and it's a bit like, you know, the Catholic Church keeps asking whether God exists, and, you know, they still have to ask that question, we still have to explain it, so I feel it's like that. Having said that, there is also, on a serious note, there's a lot of debate what on earth the word research means when it comes to the arts, and I remember when I came here the first time, and we were talking about, you know, I was talking about the vision for the Division of the Arts, which then was called the Arts Institute. One of the things I wanted to talk about, I wanted to kind of focus on, was arts research, which is why we're doing this. And one of the colleagues, a chair from one of the departments, she told me, but you also have to include creative production or creative activity, I can't remember what it was. And I said, why? She told me, because that's not arts, that's different from arts research. And it wasn't a meeting where there was no time to discuss this, but I mean, if I had 2 hours, I would have sort of started explaining what I meant by that. The other issue is that, and this is what I'm going to try to do in 10 minutes, but the other issue is that arts research is becoming more and more, especially in the United States, becoming more and more a topic of focus, particularly in the notions of the arts within university sectors, and also how we develop in the future, especially in a future where there would be less money around, which is what caused the whole debate on arts research happening in other places, including, for example, Britain, where research becomes accountable and measured, and against which you have, every 5 years, you have funding. That's becoming kind of, so it was more of a pragmatic issue that prompted this whole debate whether arts research is arts research, like someone doing research on art or someone doing art as a form of research. But from that pragmatic situation, if you like, it became much more of a very important debate in terms of arts research in general. There were other traditions which were mainly from European, sort of Central Europe, if you like, the continent as different from Britain, where actually that particular discussion has always been there. But actually it wasn't kind of discussed because it was just accepted as being part of whatever people do. It's a bit like cultural studies. I was saying, when I went to Britain a long time ago, suddenly they started talking about cultural studies. I realized that was actually, you know, what in Italian they would call lettere or letters and stuff. I said, well, actually it is, but it's not. So, I mean, it's always like that. But arts research is not just a question of terminology. It's more than that. And it also presents us with this kind of idea of what, whether it is or it's not, and also the relationship between art and research. Art is, but it may not be research. And I have the same problem all the time, the same questions and the same argument when it comes to art and education. I mean, I even wrote a paper once called Art Is and Art Is Not. So, just to give you a context, and then I know that from the 4 presentations that we're going to have, they will be better, they will do a much better job than me, because you will just see it in action. I wanted to highlight a few questions here. One of the things, as you know, and this is probably, you know about this, I'm sure, once Barnett Newman said aesthetics is for painting as ornithology is for the bird. And that's quite intriguing. I mean, in fact, actually, Adorno opened his aesthetic theory with this quote, so I'm lifting it from it. However, if you think about it, can we paraphrase that as research is for art, as ornithology is for the bird? And that's a big question, because some people would say yes, others would say no, for different reasons, and I think all the arguments are legitimate, and I don't think actually there is just one way of seeing it. However, I would say it depends on the context, and it depends on what you mean by research and what you mean by art. We have to assume that art and research as words are in and of themselves either empty or even floating signifiers, if you like. Which means that within the context that they take and within the forms that they take, they could have different meanings and they could also imply different activities. So, if you think about it, it would be yes, art and research would be extraneous to each other, just like birds and ornithology, if art and research are measured against metrics. Now, they could be metrics for money, it could be metrics for legitimation, as for example, I find myself in Dean's Council telling them why the arts need to stay in the university, and you make all these kind of arguments. It could be metrics for economics, for politics, but it could be also metrics for themselves. So, I mean, it depends what metrics you're going to use. But if they're just metrics for doing, making, and finding, if you like, and they just treat words which help me understand what research is, at least in my mind, then there is that kind of external relationship. There could be even an antagonism, which is not necessarily bad, but anyway. It would be no, so it means that art and research could become quasi-equivalent, if you like, if they are regarded as actions or acts of doing, making, and finding. And that's, again, you can have 3 hours talking just about that. But what I'm trying to do here is to accentuate the context of the question.
One of my most extreme pieces was when I really pushed my body to the limits, because I didn't ever want to die. I'm not interested in dying, but I'm interested in how far you can push the energy of the human body, how far you can go, and then see that actually our energy is almost limitless. It's not about the body, it's about mind who push you to the extremes that you never could imagine. Some of the work what really got lots of attention from the public was Rhythm Zero. Till that time, the artist of performance art was totally ridiculed, and they think that was sick, and there was exhibitionist, and there was masochist, and they just want attention. So I was just really tired of this kind of critics, and I said, okay, I'm going to make the piece to see how far public can go if the artist himself doesn't do anything. And there, very simply, I put on the table 72 objects with the instructions, I'm an object, you can do whatever you want to do with me, and I will take all responsibility for 6 hours. On the table was a rose, perfume, piece of bread, and grapes, and wine, and then was objects like really scissors and nails and metal bar, and finally was also pistol with one bullet. So basically, if the audience wanted to put a bullet into pistol, can kill me. And I really want to take this risk. I want to know what is the public about and what they're going to do in this kind of situation. It was a really difficult piece because I just stood there in the front of that table. And in the beginning, nothing really happened. Public would come, they would play with me, they would give me a rose, they would kiss me, look at me. And then public became more and more wild. They cut my neck and drink my blood. They carry me around, put me on the table, open my legs and put a knife between. The one person took the pistol, put the bullet, and see if I would really, with my own hand, push the target. The galleries came and completely go crazy, take this gun out of his hand, throw out of the window. They took a scissor, they cut my clothes, they put rose pins into my body. After 6 hours, which was like 2 in the morning, the galleries come and say the performance is over. I start moving. And start being myself, because I was there like a puppet just for them. And that moment, everybody ran away. People could not actually confront with me as a person. I remember going back to hotel, looking in the mirror, and I found a big piece of white hair.
So I wanted to give you that example. I'm sure you know about it all. I mean, you know, you would be familiar with Abramovich's work. Partly to set a different kind of context. So, So if we're still talking about art and research, and again, keep those words kind of, you know, very open in terms of what they mean. Because, I mean, if I showed you something about, I don't know, Rembrandt, then you might talk about products and whatever. But here we're talking about Abramovich, actually, like other, many other artists. What is interesting about Abramovich is that piece, as you know, in the late 2000s, actually, she did a whole set of the same pieces which were reenacted by actors in the MoMA. And that was interesting because then suddenly those pieces took a different kind of meaning in terms of how suddenly the art, and it was called, ironically, the artist's present, but the artist was not present as such, except for the last piece when she was sitting there, where actually most of the other pieces were enacted by artists, by performers, and people reacted to that. In fact, so much so that there was so much sort of engagement with it that there used to be queues, lines, you know, overnight, and one of the people who attended those lines happened to be one of my doctoral students who ended up doing a whole PhD project about that, her experience of forming a community which were sitting there in line, sleeping overnight, to be able to see Marina Abramovich. And actually that also created a whole following of Marina Abramovich, which then became an institute which they set up upstate in New York. So I mean there's an interesting kind of evolution of how those works of art develop in different contexts. But I mean, going back to the distinctions between art and this and research, I put in some kind of, you know, statements there, again, because of, we don't have much time, but I mean, just for the way of the way I have been looking at this throughout my own research. So the first thing is that not all forms of research with an arts focus amount towards research, and that's a very difficult question, because a lot of colleagues who have been doing arts research in the various universities I worked with, but also colleagues I engaged with, they took different ways of doing this. So for example, there is a way of externalizing an arts practice, looking at it as a socio-scientific kind of work, through socio-scientific methodology, and then write a dissertation about that or whatever and present the results. But that is that arts research? Or is that art research about art? Or research on art? So the distinction here, and this is not being elitist as some people would say, there are various reasons for it, is that in order to think about arts research by dint of its own eminence, we have to make sure that there is this distinction between arts research and research on art or research as art. And the distinctions are not to say one is better than the other, but just for us to clarify, I mean, 2 weeks ago, I was in Northern Illinois, actually, with a group of arts researchers, and we were trying to put some benchmarks together in order to be able to help each other look at PhDs by practice and what would that look like and how we can kind of measure that. We all know how to do it, but we never talk about it. So we never kind of, you know, in a way, there's not. And also, I personally am very, very anxious of setting up standards and criteria, because they could become then very much reified in a set of objectives which then would sort of stall the whole idea of what arts research is all about. So there are various issues there. The second one is that, and this is maybe my hobby horse, is that arts research is prompted by art's immanence, art in itself and of itself, its own interiority. So further iterations of that can only succeed, in my opinion, if we keep that in mind. If we lose sight of the immanence of art as art, and I don't mean art for art's sake, but art as art, whatever that means again, within its own practice, within its own kind of authenticity or even autonomy, then there's a problem there. Because again, it could become, art becomes a subject of social scientific research. Art becomes a subject of other forms of research, which is fine, but that's not arts research. I mean, and the distinction is important, again, not because it's better or worse, but it's important to define that. Thirdly, is that beyond itself, arts research refuses to be externalized. And that's a very important thing, because there is a risk all the time, and some of the colleagues here, they get really exasperated by me keeping on this, is that I don't want the arts to become instrumentalized. Even when it's a good thing to do so for various reasons, health or whatever, but actually, to me, if that's going to happen, then we're talking about a different set of criteria. We're talking about different methodologies. So that's fine again, but don't call it arts research. Call it something else, because otherwise it starts confusing things. It's a bit like me trying to start using mathematical things to describe art, and I'm not a mathematician. That my work is not going to be on mathematics research, it's going to be on art research, even though I'm using other means and forms of mediation. Now, why is that? And some time ago, I wrote a paper for a journal in Porto, actually, and I came up with some of these kind of trying to work these things out. So again, I'm rushing here. I'm sorry, I'm not used to do succinct presentations, so that's my problem. So I think that art needs to go, I mean, it goes outside simply being used as a form of mediation. And I'm not saying that shouldn't be done. I'm saying that if we're talking about arts research, within the realm of arts research, we need to make those distinctions. And it's asserting, in arts research, it asserts its own spaces of autonomy. But also autonomy not as a kind of elitist, rarefied thing, but also autonomy within everyday life. As you will find in a lot of projects, including some of the projects you see today. The second one is that, what is this arts autonomy? Arts autonomy is not to make an arts a case for art's sake, as in this kind of bourgeois reification of art. But actually, it asserts art as a form of, as knowing as a practice, and it could be being as practice, could be also something. But also, it's a form of unlearning, and it has that kind of quality. And if you see this happening in art pedagogy in the studio, where rather than just accrue knowledge, actually we critique knowledge and also unlearn knowledge by way of knowing, so to speak. So there's that kind of paradoxical aporetic notion. And that would also start moving within the realm of non-art. So arts, it becomes sort of arts other, its own autonomy, as a form of non-art. And again, we inherited this thanks to modernism, which actually really engaged with this kind of non-concept. So what does non-art imply here? Non-art would mean, actually, that art can continuously practice without having to be described or externalized into other forms which try to describe it. Art stands for itself, can describe itself, it is its own being. And it's one of those qualities which are different from others, but it's one of those qualities which human beings have. So therefore they use it, and it's just another form of how we engage with the world. So again, it's not privileged. It's privileged in that it's different from, but it's not privileged as in it's better or worse than other things. And last but not least, arts and describability, I think, is practices arts research. So if you ask me what is arts research, I would say start from the fact and from the quibbles that we always have about what is art and its own descriptions or its indescribability. And I think that would be a very good point of departure, one of them, not the only one, to start to begin to engage with arts research. So a fourth distinction would mean that arts research is an affirmation of its own indescribability, and also its refusal to be an instrument of other than art. And that poses a very interesting, albeit sometimes problematic, situation. Art in schools, for example, art in education. We always know that if you start going in art in education with this kind of notion that you take away the critique of art, suddenly art becomes an instrument for being a good mathematician or for being a good person, then you have a problem there, because art disappears immediately. It becomes just an instrument, another tool for something else. And that's a problem, because we then lose all the possibilities that we have when we make art. And art didn't come from heaven. It's a human ability that we have identified and we have developed as humans. So, amongst other abilities. The old Pablo is always handy. Okay, I apologize for the condensed way I've done this, but questions for towards the end, because once you start sort of engaging with some of these presentations, some of this stuff hopefully will start to make sense. I'm not sure, but I can't guarantee that. So now I'm very pleased to present to you Liz Anna Kozik, and she's from the Nelson Institute of Environmental Studies. As I said, Liz is also the 2017 Sir Reichel Frank winner. Actually, it's an award, one of the awards that we give in this university to arts practitioners. And the title of this thing, this presentation, is going to be Science Outreach on the Prairie. Yeah?
Yes.
Over to you.
get inside of this soon. Yes, go forward.
I'm Lizanna Kozik. I am a PhD student here at UW-Madison. And I applied to that PhD program saying, hey, I'm going to do my dissertation as a comic. And they said, cool, let's do it. And so that's a broad overview of the kind of work that I do and how I exist. My background was as a art student, first my master's in Rhode Island, and then my undergrad in Rhode Island and my master's here at UW. But now I've transitioned over to environmental studies. And so broadly speaking, this is what my work looks like. I deal with the history of prairie restoration here in the United States. And for some of you who aren't from around here, prairie restoration, essentially this region and straight south and straight west used to be tall grass prairie. So that'll give you a sense of what prairie can really look like. It's a instead of trees, we think of 1,000 different species of grasses and forbs and flowers. And in the past, since about 1950, here at UW, we have been doing research on how to bring this prairie back. And it's a very complicated history and has all sorts of interweavings with colonialism. And so that's what I'm studying as a PhD student here. But to get to that point, this is where I grew up, and I, for a very long time, felt like I came from nowhere, because this is like a classic American suburb that you could find anywhere in the country, same sort of houses, same sort of street layouts, and I felt like I came from nowhere. Then I did my undergraduate at the Rhode Island School of Design, and I was like, oh my god, finally, I'm living in a place that has a history. And it took moving to Rhode Island to sort of reflect back on that assumption and to start thinking about what is the landscape that I came from. And so at first, what this meant was just drawing prairie plants and studying the interrelation between species and whatnot. But once I got into my master's program, building up to my PhD, I started realizing how much the human hand exists in prairie restoration. How much of the prairies I experience, like this is Lurie Garden, downtown Chicago, and this is Montrose Harbor, also in Chicago where I lived for a while. Their prairies so rarely actually look like this. They look like this. There are spaces that people have built and places that have very human histories. And so that's what got me into looking at this really complicated history. Because the prairies I grew up around, the prairies I've always known, they were all restorations. Not a fragment of the past, but a recreation. So my research in the past, well, this is the project I did as under the very generous grant from the Arts Institute, Art Division of the Arts, was to study the history of the first prairie restoration, which is right here on campus, and looking at the human stories that sort of created this prairie. Additionally, I started collaborating with researchers who study the scientific processes of these prairie restorations. These are two students who just finished over at University of Michigan, Anna and Chad, and finding ways to share their research to connect not only the history of these prairies, but the ongoing active research that brings scientists into these spaces. Additionally, the unavoidable subject when dealing with prairie restoration is the presence of Indigenous American lives, the erasure of their experiences, and even of their languages, where we speak the French word prairie instead of Muscoda, or we're on Ho-Chunk land right now, so Hoskaiza. So, when I was in Rhode Island, I worked with Professor Robert Emlin, who is a professor of American Decorative Arts, which sounds like it could be the most boring thing, but actually I fell completely in love. And it was in part due to these chests and the way he talked about them, because these are so like early colonial American Connecticut River Valley dowry chest. And what's fascinating about them, and this only happens in this area, is this insane intricate floral ornament that covers every surface, but only flat, just across the surface of the front of the chest and nowhere else. And so this led to a meditation on like, where did these florals come from? How did these people feel about the environment they lived in as they carved these chests and chose to ornament their houses with these plants? And if you look at environmental history and the way environmental history has studied colonial American experiences of the landscape, at the time they were terrified, both culturally, religiously speaking, of the wilderness is a in wilderness there is no tiling, sowing, nor planting. So in the common field of this world there grows little or nothing but what the carnal and natural hearts of sinners bring forth. And so you look again at these chests, reading these passages written at the time, and go, how was this related to this anxiety about the landscape, this new place that these settler colonialists had just arrived at, pushed out tribal nations? And so you see these hyper complicated floral motifs compressed, safely contained within just the front surfaces of these chests. And so this is one of Professor Robert Enlund's sort of life-changing lectures for me, because from there I wanted to ask, what plants are we looking at? What plants are we responding to? And so this is the methodology which I approach my research, which is to say, here's a prairie restoration that's in northern Illinois. And you know, this isn't an inaccurate painting of what it looks like. And you know, if I start detailing individual plants, you can like, it's kind of what a photograph looks like. But to fully understand the space and to talk about the communities of plants within this space, you have to go beyond literal perspectives. So that's what I'm gonna ask you guys to do. All right, so everybody's got pens and pencils and note cards. And we're gonna do a fun thing. So this is a farm in Shanahan, Illinois. It's right near Bourbonnais, if you know the bears. But I love this piece. For a detail, I'll go on to. So first, what I'm going to ask you guys to do is take one of your note cards, and you're going to draw a frame for me. Okay. So we're going to look at this picture, and I want you just to look at it and like, what could this roughly be sketched as? So do like the roughest, quickest drawing, right? Because what we have, can you see those up there? Cool. So we've got this straight horizon, this layer of darker plants, and then these plants in the foreground. So like, just do that roughly out. Don't think too hard about it. So just, you know, a quick rough idea. Just to like, part of, I work with Linda Berry here on campus, and she's a comic artist, and part of what these quick sketch drawings do, as she talks about, is just getting you to actually look at a picture, to actually see what you're seeing. So, pencils down. Now I'm going to ask you to draw something else. Let's get another note card. And now I've broken down the four species that are visible in this photograph. You can see this is a Solidago canadensis or Canada goldenrod, Queen Anne's lace or Dacus carota, common milkweed or Asclepias syriaca, and Zea maize clord. So let's try this. Draw me a goldenrod. I'm debating over whether I show you guys this idea. But so the key with most goldenrods, there's a whole family of goldenrods that look particularly like this.
is we've got alternating long skinny leaves that go up and down the entire length, and then alternating flower heads, just like that, little leaves at the base. Probably heard a lot about it because monarch butterflies love it and it takes care of itself just fine. So it can, once you plant a few, it'll keep growing and expanding on its own. This is a trickier one. Dacus corona, a friend from Europe who has joined this collection of North American plants. So if you didn't know, Queen Anne's lace is wild carrot, and theoretically you could eat it, but also they grow on roadsides and you don't want the materials they pick up.
Isn't there one that looks very much like it that's pretty, like
some parsnips? Yes. Wild parsnip looks like this, but it has yellow flowers, and if you touch it, sap. Like, you get huge, swelling, disgusting. Ugh. It's like every time I need to draw that plant, I end up in Google image search, and then I see mostly disgusting injuries. Great. And our last friend, one of my least favorite plants to draw. CMAs comes from a plant called teosinte, which is native to Central America. So you're 3 out of 4 for North American plants. And I find a lot with grasses, which technically corn is. Scientific illustrations help so much because they're so tall and generally skinny that photographs are very difficult to read. So let's get a new card. So what we all have now is a little cheat sheet for each of these species. Right? So we got our goldenrod, our milkweed, wild carrots, and corn. And so with this cheat sheet in hand, we can look back at this photograph, and suddenly we have all the puzzle pieces we need to draw this picture. It's hard, because I want to show you both what I'm doing in the image tab back and forth. So I have this rough shape here, right? And I know, down in front, we've got a lot of goldenrod. Here, I'm gonna get this camera to not be covered by my hand. May seem simple and intuitive for this photo because I've chosen an easy one for us to start with. Here, let's look at it again. Because it really is just those 4 species and they're pretty consistently laid out in a regular rhythm, right? Because we go goldenrod, goldenrod, wild carrot, goldenrod, goldenrod, lost it, milkweed. And we have this lovely background of corn. But this is the method by which I get a data sheet from a scientist that's a list of plant names. And from that list of plant names, and based on their frequency in that list of plant names, I create these drawings. So you can imagine, like, even this is about 2 hours north of where that photograph was taken. And you can see, oh God, there's so much going on. But we can break it down pretty easily where we see, oh, actually, our friend Canada goldenrod is right here. We've got a milkweed plant right here. And we add in a few friends, like rosinweed, who's these big flowers right here. Black-eyed Susan, who's growing down here. brome, prairie brome, which is this grass here. And lastly, big blue stem, the iconic plant of the prairie. I can tell you based on color, is right back here. So I'm assuming that we don't have time to do another drawing, so we want to get to everybody. But so this is the research site that I'm working on right now. And I can tell you there are about 30 to 50 species in this photograph. Luckily, I was just at the site. This is a photo from Monday. This is a remnant prairie that was never plowed. It was a hillside that they could never farm on. And so these plants are all still there. And so I work with researchers who are studying this site as an example for prairie restoration. And you know, like, you can look at this, but you can't comprehend every species that's there. But once I break it down into a drawing, much like this guy, we can begin to understand everything that's going on. And so that's how art is. I'm not just a tool for these scientists. Art allows me to access things and to understand things, and allows my scientists to access and understand things in a completely different way that can only happen through drawing.
Well, I'm very pleased to present to you my colleagues from Porto, Catarina Martens and Catarina Meida, who are from the Institute for Research in Arts, Design and Society at the University of Porto, actually Christine as well, so they're all from the... But they're going to talk to us about the LABIA, which is the Laboratory for Research in Arts Education. We have a little blurb here, we can read all about the background, so I don't need to read it.
My name is Catarina Martins, and this is Catarina Almeida, and we both came, as John just said, from the University of Porto, Faculty of Fine Arts, and from the Research Institute in Art, Design and Society. So let me begin for a brief contextualization, introducing the Institute. This is an art and design research center hosted by the Faculty of Fine Arts, and it exists since 2011. The Institute headquarters are also located at the Faculty of Fine Arts. Here you can see the gardens of the faculty. I am the director of this institute, and we have about 30 integrated researchers and about 100 collaborating researchers. UW-Madison is the basis for research projects that bring together teams of professors, students, and also artists. They are part of the faculty staff, but also from the School of Music and Performing Arts that also integrates the Institute. In addition to the projects, we organize conferences, seminars, artistic residencies, publications, and also in terms of artistic research, the artistic practice itself in the form of exhibitions or concerts, for instance, can be considered and framed as research. What we will talk about today is one of the platforms that functions as a space for research in arts education. We call it LABIA, the Research Laboratory in Arts Education. This presentation is not, as you can see, exactly an academic paper, but we will try simultaneously to describe what we are doing in this laboratory and to give some clues of the ways we are conceptualizing it.
Yeah, so we have to read because we are not as fluent speakers as you are. Sorry for that, and we hope to make ourselves understood. So as Catarina was saying, inside UW-Madison we have this LABIA, which is a laboratory of experimental research in different educational contexts in which the artistic and the educational are confronted. So we use this word laboratory. And of course that we are aware of the strategic use of the term laboratory, but we like to think of it much more in the sense that the artist Thomas E. Shorn used the term laboratory for his installation called Critical Laboratory. It was part of an exhibition called Mirror's Edge in 1999. And like what E. Shorn, well, here you have an image of it, like what E. Shorn says about this installation, Critical Laboratory, we at LABIA also think of us as a nomadic project able to be rebuilt in other places. we don't actually have physical headquarters. So we at Latvia think of us as a mentally transportable space, exactly how Ishan talked about this critical laboratory. So we basically are an idea with more focused ideas within this main idea. And we are guided by Ishan's formula for his installation, that is the aim to be critical, to create resistance, and to be disobedient. So we this is very purposeful in our daily action in Latvia. We ask ourselves how to gain a critical position, and how can one be critical in what we do? How can one be critical even more when one operates within the institution to be addressed by critical judgment? We appropriate Michel Foucault's words about this criticality, that is, how not to be governed in this way, how not to be governed by this rationale, by this grid of thought in which we are inscribed. And we imagine ourselves, following Ishan's formula, we imagine ourselves in Latvia as critical thinkers, as resistant subjects, as disobedient researchers. And as long as our image of us, our image of ourselves, is constantly brought into discussion, and as long as we problematize our writing, and as long as we voluntarily set our research under scrutiny, we are accepting to be exposed and to resignify, to rethink, and to reimagine what we do in Latvia. And this necessarily includes the terms in which we assess our own work, and the terms or the very idea of criticality. Also, the idea of criticality in its alarming risk of becoming a commodity in academia, which also it's becoming a buzzword as well. So this idea of a pedagogy against the state that we borrow from Dennis Atkinson might be very useful for us in Latvia as a theoretical direction. So the state of things ought to be comprehended in its genealogy in an attempt that the present enables destabilization, or rather acts of presentation instead of acts of representation or acts of reproduction of the known. So we will go on just presenting the three micro projects, or better, three lines of research that we have within Latvia. And all of these lines of research mix action research in a way. And we think of these three lines of research as ways of destabilization of crystallized routines. And the first routine that we want to destabilize, and that constitutes the basis of our work there, is that the separation of theory and practices, or theory and practice, is a theoretical division. So it might be questioned that way. So these are the three lines, and Katerina will begin with the first one.
Well, one of the projects developed within Latvia consisted in artistic residencies in primary schools. The project was called CREART, Creative School Partnerships with Visual Artists. To understand this project, it is important to acknowledge that in Portugal, primary school teachers do not develop specific skills in the arts, even though they are responsible in schools to develop the arts with children. Prior to this project, we did some work on how the arts are mobilized and are constructed within the curriculum, and we concluded that what happens in school is a kind of an alchemy of the arts. It means that when transposed into school subjects, the knowledge that is supposed to represent a specific academic discipline, in this case the arts, is transformed. What is maintained is the name, but this name is only a level. Under the level, however, come ways of reasoning about the child's development, learning processes, and problem solving organized into layers that aim to change and transform the child into a certain kind of person. And these ways of reasoning rarely have some relation with the arts or the way the arts are acted and thought in contemporary times by the artists themselves. School subjects, Thomas Popovitz argues, have little to do with the network and relations that form and give order to the norms of participation, truth, and recognition in the various academic fields associated with school subjects. This alchemy happens in primary schools when we come to talk about the arts. So CREART was thought as a reaction to this diagnosis. What we proposed within the project was to develop artistic projects in schools, allowing a collaborative work between artists, of course artists interested in the educational and pedagogical dimensions, with teachers and students. The artists went on a regular basis to the schools and started to construct a relationship that allowed for the development of the different projects in these schools. The project aimed to develop an approximation, experimentation and ways of relating to the contemporary artistic practices through the processes explored in each school's project. The artists concentrated much more on the processes of articulating ideas and constructing new meanings than in the repetition of certain grammars of knowledge or techniques. We tried to open the school to the presence of the artistic, exploring the complexities and tensions of art, fostering ruptures in the order of the school exercises and its didactics, by disturbing the distribution of knowledge and practices, as well as ways of saying, seeing and doing. It opened up the possibility of discussing the roles of the arts within the curriculum, their usual instrumentalization to achieve certain goals in other subjects, and the rhetoric of effects that is expressed in that use of the arts. It's tried to create a space for unlearning what usually the art represents across school curriculum. In a way, the different practices broken routines and were able to create fissures in the existing frameworks of arts practice and knowledge in schools. We were aware that the presence of the artist in the schoolroom, in the classroom, was the first change. But with it came other changes, sometimes so simple as to move school furniture or to use the space and the body in other ways. And we know well that this per se is not the condition for changing practices, but we always try to think about each move and what it meant in terms of power-knowledge relations within the classroom. But at the same time, we try to deconstruct the idea of art and the artist as a field and an exceptional subject through a close contact and collaborative work. Our aim was to construct learning spaces embedded in flexible work processes that do not answer to psychological aims, but that open to questioning what is to teach and to learn beyond the traditional practices that are defined by binaries: good, bad, desirable, undesirable, success, failure, etc., that very often exclude those that are classified as less talented or that deviate from what is established as the right path to follow, particularly by teachers whose references are much more marked by a specific aesthetics of beauty that has nothing to do, for instance, with what art is and does in contemporaneity. So within this project, we seek to experiment a post-critical approach instead of the philosophies of representation of the student, of the teacher, of knowledge. We are much more interested in the idea of becoming rather than the stable and fixed identities, and to work towards the unknown instead of reproducing what is already known. So, metaphorically speaking, we approached the figure of the artist within the educational environment as a virus. A virus is an infective agent capable of disrupting the normal state of an organism. It refers to a kind of poison. We are interested in this metaphor in its disruptive nature. The virus is always an event in the normative functioning of an organism or a machine. A virus provokes infections, and infections are the invasions caused by strange agents in a body. We see an art practitioner entering in a school as somebody entering into an organism and starts challenging its capacities. It is a kind of a disobedient agent. This metaphor is also very productive because it questions the neat, orderly, controlled side of power devices. Its political force is to shake the power by finding deviations to a path that determines what each one should be. The project allowed us at Labia to displace ourselves in terms of how we can think about arts education, not only at a more theoretical level within academia, but how research can be performed from within. The idea of change, in terms of changing arts practices in schools, acquired a different tone as it became, in itself, the way of asking about the questions we ask and the desires we formulate about arts education and schools.
And so the second research line that we have, as you can see, we are used same ideas or similar ideas that cross all these different lines of research. And so concerning this one, this project is, or this line is undergoing, we intended to have different fieldworks moments, and we already had one last January when we organized a winter school in the north of Portugal, in a small village. A winter school, it was intended for PhD researchers in arts and arts education. And it, this was the image. Well, through this winter school, we intended to experiment on this idea of disobedient and disruptive practices that can also generate disobedient ways of researching. And this winter school happened in an old primary school that in the meanwhile was converted in a center for artistic residences. We had around, it was an international call, and we had around 20 participants plus staff and invited tutors. We organized participants in three groups, each led by one of the invited tutors. And it was sort of an immersive and intensive experience, as we had lived together 24 hours a day for three consecutive working days. The days began with this modality that we have called breakfast with, where everyone, all the participants participated and discussed the topics brought by each tutor, one per morning. And after breakfast, groups separated and went working in well, dedicated and adapted program. Despite the disobedient practice that might have followed individually to or in the practice of these participants, for us organizers, the winter school was an attempt to experiment with alternative formats for PhD research, creating spaces for thinking and questioning that are not conventional for academy and research. And as you can see, he used the alternative in quotes because we are, of course, very aware that, and we do not claim to have introduced an original format or an unseen format. We are very aware that it is a very naturalized format among artists and in the professional art world. But we are interested in seeing how this contamination might work when we migrate one format from the art world into the educational context or the research context. So we are interested in what happens when we dislocate it and introduce it in the areas of education and research. What clashes and what seductions occur, for example. And because we see a bridge between these two worlds, we appropriate particular aspects of the artist's subjectivity that are in the core of the artist's residences. And the aspects are this traveling individual, flexible, mobile, and globalized. Also, the idea of an isolated mind that is in need for a retreat to further develop research fully focused, and simultaneously and a bit also paradoxically, if you want, the relational subject that learn from peers and from different inputs. So these characteristics that are common to artist residences and in which we were interested when we experimented with this format with PhD researchers, they are all characteristics that we imagine as productive aspirations for PhD research, and they result from the merge of a notion of Greek school of the free space and time, allied to a modern notion of school in what it provides in terms of focus and discipline. Our intent in Labia to question the orderly traditional formats of discussion used is largely informed by examples and experiences collected mostly from the territory of art, from the art world, where we think learning from failed projects and sort of perverted situations proves to be very enriching. Where else rather than in the art world is the potential of the disruptive format so close to becoming a commodity? And we have to be aware of this risk, as I was saying a while ago in Latvia. So for example, when we think of the white cube, and when white cube was regarded and able to host an increasingly dematerialized art, other formats were quickly adopted to answer the new demands, and they quickly lost their disruptive potentialities. For example, we have the relational aesthetics in the 90s, that have turned the art piece from the experience of the object to the objectification of experience. But this experience could no longer be hung in a wall. And so it demanded different spaces for the distribution of the work of art. But these different spaces quickly were neutralized, and soon the logic of market took over the destabilization appetite of the relational artists to impose the thirst for numbers, profit-making, and advertisement disguised as forms of interactivity, participation, and democratization. So there are a lot of examples that we could give, but for example, we have the research pavilion of the Venice Biennale of 2015, but here we have another example of the Lyon 2005 Biennale, where this was in the time of relational aesthetics, precisely as I was saying. And this example of the 2005 Lyon Biennale is a very powerful one, where the team of curators, well, claiming to be introducing disruptive models of interactivity, they paraded all dressed by the brand Hermès in the vernissage. So, and Hermès was the main sponsor. So it showed exactly the power of the appropriation of the market logic, say that, in that moment. So these formats were never very critical, neither self-critical, seeking instead to adapt to the demanded circumstances of art and market in the institutionalized spaces. And these experiential formats have ended neutralized by that potential, by their potential disruptiveness. So we realize that in order to develop disobedient ways of researching, the disobedient and disruptive practices ought to be dynamic and self-critical. They have to be a means rather than an end in order to avoid exactly crystallization and therefore commodification. So per se, a change in format is of little use to transform the institutionalized practices when the order of discourse or the conditions of visibility remain untouched or unchanged. And we have to keep this in mind when we address, for example, this line of research in Latvia or precisely the example of the Winter School. And that's why we think of it as much more a part of a research line rather than as a project, concluded project or finished project in itself. Going back to the example of the art world, where else, rather than the art world, are people so concerned with disruptiveness as a content that they barely consider the disruptiveness of the formats used to address that disruptive content? Or even when we are aware of this paradoxical situation, how can one jump over our own professional shadows and traditions of discourse into something moved differently, into something moved by improvisation or experimentation, for example? We have another example, which is, well, I will talk very briefly about it, which is this example of Manifesto 6. Manifesto is a sort of biennial in Europe, and this Manifesto 6 failed as an art world project because it eventually was cancelled a few weeks before start. It was thought as an exhibition at school, but it just didn't work in this art world context where, sets rules is a culture of spectacle aiming to get the next commodity. So it didn't work as a commodity, and it was cancelled in the end. And so Manifesto 6, after failing, it turned into what received the name United Nations Plaza, which was, and here you see the alternative again in quotes, because it was thought as a school and simultaneously as an art project, but already out of the institution of the art world. And it sought to elaborate. It was basically a project comprised of a program of seminars, roundtables, debates, workshops. So it was conceived as a sort of program. And it sought to elaborate new ways of transcending traditional boundaries between research, academy, and art. And in some moments they had it, but in other moments they used the very same traditional formats of academia and research to address their disobedient contents and disobedient practices. And just concerning this aspect, I have here a quote from Tirva Zolgat, that is one of the founders of this United Nations Plaza, where he says that although it is artists who have organized some of the most compelling discursive experiments, symposium curators compulsively belittle the artists as innocent bystanders, claiming to speak in their name and preferring to emulate the epistemic ceremonials of the humanities, as we usually do, and the humanities emulate the natural sciences. And of course, that well, we see that in recent years the Academy has been lending its models to the art world. And here in Latvia, and in this line of research, we are also emulating an artistic format to see how it could disturb, maybe, and transform in some ways this socialized ways of debate in academia. But of course, that evaluation and success is or becomes an issue. It can be a problem if you think about it. And actually, when we have presented this winter school, we have a video of 40 minutes that we have presented in a conference in Italy in last September. In the audience, one of the questions was exactly that. So how can you speak about the success of that experiment? And we don't have an answer for that, but we of course, we take for sure that if we are looking for disobedient practices, we cannot make the same traditional questions. And regarding this aspect, and I'm almost finishing, there's another quote of this. This is what was one of the curators of Manifesto 6, and he speaks about Manifesto 6, but what he says perfectly fits our winter school. So in order to be successful, this project must fail by the existing standards of the exhibition industry. It should propose a new articulation of the ways of assessment and not fall prey to the trap of proposing innovation yet using same criteria for its evaluation. We will have another moment of field work trying to go further with it, with this idea of disobedient format, to have disobedient practice. So we will have a sort of reenactment of the school in next March or April with our PhD students. So maybe we will then have further insights on how this contaminates individual researches of these students.
And so our last project, it's a third project within Labia, and it's a kind of our newborn research project. The project only exists at the moment from the point of view of its theoretical placement. It starts from the problematization of the idea of what an archive is and how can it be simultaneously part of the present in terms of the different layers that make the present possible, but also as a materiality ready to be reused and reinvented. Mapping, storycizing, collecting, combining, experimenting are some of the verbs in which we think when we talk about this. To speak of these verbs in the gerund is not a coincidence. We are interested in the performative dimension of the archive. Our approach to the archive is double. In a way, the archive is itself part of the present and its a priori, and we understand the a priori as the condition of reality for statements, which means the conditions of possibility and what gives reasonability to arts education practices in the present, nevertheless the differences among them. Foucault described it as being defined as the group of rules that characterize the discursive practice. The archive is thus the space of specific rules and practices that make events possible. In Foucault's words, the archive is first the law of what can be said, the system that governs the appearance of statements as unique events. But the archive is also that which determines that all these things said do not accumulate endlessly in an amorphous mass, nor are they inscribed in an unbroken linearity. So we see the archive as the system of functioning of statements. If we think about the context of arts education, we must think about all those statements, practices, objects, spaces, and places that put together with different intensities the artistic practices and the relational side of education. We seek to understand, to storycize, and to experiment through this. Just a brief example, Katarina was talking about the project of the alternative formats of the school. This project is intersected by the principles that we are now trying to put in this project of a live archive. Not only past alternative art schools such as Bauhaus, Black Mountain College, their actors, the formats used within the arts world to reimagine the school are part of these conditions of possibility and part of our archive, but we also combine different strategies, propositions, formats, statements in order to experiment with this archive material. The other way we look to these archival materialities is through Walter Benjamin's notion of excavation. Benjamin argues that looking to the past is like digging. However, those who merely make an inventory of their findings while failing to establish the exact location of where in today's ground the ancient treasures have been stored up, cheats himself to his richest prize. a good archaeological report not only informs us about the strata from which its findings originate, but also gives an account of the strata which first had to be broken through. In fact, when we talk about the archive, we are simultaneously talking about the possibility of collections of statements, objects, practices, but also as the possibility of new encounters and relations. It is a project that materializes a kind of a history of the present of arts education practices, not through a historicist approach and opening it up to experimentation. The archive is seen not as a repository, but as a device and a toolbox in which some things matter for the present. In that sense, it is simultaneously the experiential from experience and experimentational from experiment side of the archive that are put to the test. If we see the archive as a series of encounters where the primary substance is not the artifact or the subject viewing it, but the encounter which involves a fusion of subject and object in a unified event of experiencing, then we seek to take the matter of the archive as a starting point for the establishment of new relationships in educational settings. More than what matters in this project is the focus on how to make events and encounters that matter. Even if it starts totally from the archive material and we are just reenacting, remaking, repeating, what interests us in this gesture is the difference in the repetition. Our time has gone already, but just 1 minute more for a brief conclusion. The three lines we have just presented try to enact and perceive the disruptive potential of artistic practices when they approach educational settings. We seek to understand how these proposals of an imminently experimental nature create relationships between doing, thinking and feeling, and what their nature is. In all of them, there is an idea of contamination that calls into question any ideology of a sense or originality. In the first project, the contamination was through the figure of the artist as a virus. In the second, the idea of a school as a place to train disobedience through alternative formats coming from the art world. The third calls into attention that we are very interested in the proposition of practices in order to perceive the places from which we have come and the grids of rationality that make these propositions possible. These enunciations that we call arts education research stress the idea that theory and practice are inseparable actors and that arts education cannot simply be the translation of the arts into education, nor can it be the instrumentalization of the arts to reach educational goals. There is a tension in the gap between the arts and education, and this tensional space, understood as a political space, is what we want to maintain alive and undefined. So thank you very much.
So now Katarina will be joined with Mike, Christina and Daniel, and talk about Gerhard. Which is a choreographic laboratory. By the way, Gerda is, I'm being told, are they the guilds of the fish. So you have to tell us why.
Oh, no.
Okay.
Gerda is a transdisciplinary laboratory, choreographic laboratory, with the aim of improving and encourage the creation and discussion of contemporary art. Each laboratory is guided by an invited artist. We are presenting today my work in this laboratory. With the result from the week of work, we intend to reflect on space and memory where artists interact with the community and with the local references. The priority of the project is to promote and stimulate the creation of performing arts through proposals that demonstrate contemporary approaches and establish with the city an exchange of individual or collective artistic experiences and to strain relations between artists and the social, political and cultural context in the city. So my work is, this become my text. It is not the movement of the body text nor a text about the movement of the body. It is the body as a text. Is the experience of a text in space and time. The text is the time and the space of body movements. This become my text, is a possible scenario of thoughts. There is a behavior syntax that is very similar to the syntax that regulates the use of words. Language is adultly a form of behavior. It can say something like a way of life. Then saying something is in all circumstances the same as doing something. The aim of this project was to free the rhizomatic pathways from the cliches of the movement of bodies so that they could regain their original liberating and paradoxical function of body language. I will talk during the video. Don't look at me, please. Numa das visitas à casa da minha sogra, a ver meus livros, eu encontrei...
106, meu Deus!
Estes cadernos sobre cinema.
Estes antes e depois mandava-os.
Ah, sim.
E depois fazia o seu passeio dominical, que era isso que eu queria que a Gabi fizesse pela cidade. Comprava sempre um buquê de flores brancas e numa esculturas imaginadas ela punha as flores dos seus queridos amantes. Este filme tem muito a ver ainda com esta coisa do expressionismo alemão. No cinema, como, tanto na maneira como foi filmado, como no enredo da história. Pensei também no vídeo para jogar-nos em algumas situações com o vídeo, um bocado para ir buscar esta coisa do expressionismo alemão, das sobreposições de imagem, das distorções. Só tenho pena que as pessoas não consigam ver a preto e branco. Portanto, vamos tentar aproximar o mais possível a preto e branco quando elas entrarem aqui. Vêem sempre alguma cor. E eu estava preto e branco mesmo, o meu desejo. Ainda há de ser inventado uns óculos. Se calhar já. Uns óculos para ver o preto e branco.
Primeiro trabalho que eu vos vou propor é com os pins que o Leonardo mandou. Não me mandou os pins. Eu dei-lhe 10 segundos.
Ah, ok.
Se pela escrita vocês conseguem lembrar o movimento. Eu acho que esta sequência de movimentos, vamos trabalhá-la, mas acho que pode ser uma base para trabalhar com a história na cabeça. Eu vou introduzir essa estante com coisas que vai ter outras coisas. Thank you.
os amantes que ela mata.
Muitas coisas para procurar.
Thank you.
So what we have seen here is a video of the making of Gelre. Gelre is the name of, it is both the name of the whole project, of the whole laboratory, but within it, it has different moments of public presentations, which also received the name Gelre. So this Gelre happened in last May, and it it was headed and directed by Cristina Mendanha's choreographer and dancer, and it also had the presence of Peter Michael Dietz and Gabi Barros as dancers there. And Cristina is also a member of our research institute. She was interested in exploring the relationship of writing and body movement or body improvisation towards the development of a methodology of contamination of this mutual of these two worlds. And see how it could work both with professional dancers as well as then develop it to work with her young pupils in the dance school. So this is what she is interested in exploring in this methodology, although this was mostly the making of the public presentation as an artistic performance of the piece. And I accompanied the whole process providing video materials for the final piece, and also acting as an observer and researcher aiming to document the process. So we are focusing also on this idea of documentation, and we are trying to explore the collision of these presumed different approaches to knowledge production that are the academy and the performing arts. So documentation here serves both the interests of Cristina, since she can use the documented material to either advertise her artistic piece, and she can use it also to provide feedback to dancers during rehearsals, as we have done in the process of making of. And also she can use this documentation material as reflexive material in order to further develop her educational methodology that I was speaking about, of writing body movement. And besides Cristina's interest, documentation here serves also my research interest as well, since with it I am able to explore the performing discursive reach of documentation to produce research. And this is to say that I am interested in how through documentation or how through problematizing this idea of documentation we can go from an artistic practice into what we can call artistic research. And I will just briefly speak of three short premises that come to my mind when I think of this idea of documentation making the bridge or the process from artistic practice into artistic research. And the first premise is that of the widespread and well-known stance that documentation is never neutral. In this way, documentation goes beyond merely describing a reality. So every form of documentation, be it photography, video making, writing notes, drawings, whatever, every form of documentation is shaped by the body that executes documentation. And to a certain degree, this means that all ways of documenting are subjective, and that especially in the field of performing arts, we can benefit from incorporated knowledge and find ways to translate this knowledge into documents. So therefore, my presence as researcher and documenter during the whole residency, from scratch to final piece, is supported and is largely informed by this consideration that the more I am involved in the process, the more I will adapt the documentary, or the more I will convey the documentary to the research aims that are on the table, mine and Cristina's as well. So rather than a report of the truth of occurrences here, documentation becomes an extension of the object it documents. So documentation in this way actively performs because it also gains a certain degree of autonomy. And this leads us to the second premise, that is that documents can perform. And what do I mean with this idea of performativity in documentation? I think that this performative dimension is multi-layered, and I will approach it relying on my own experience and my process of documenting. And this process of documenting, in my case, goes from building a knowledge container, this idea of a knowledge container. So I build a knowledge container, and from this knowledge container, this knowledge container will be my feedstock, my like source of raw material, from which these different levels of performativity can start from. And so, for instance, in this sort of 15 minutes video, of this making of Gelha, I dug in around 160 gigabytes of raw material, all organized by theme, name of camera use, day of recording, and spent around 32-35 hours, doesn't matter, reviewing the material, and selecting and editing and designing the final piece. So subtitles, rendering, and exports are out of that. But what matters here is that the same container of knowledge allows me to produce the quick teaser for distribution of the artistic work. It allows me to produce also the full-length recording, or what we call the conventional recording, for future memory or for individual archives of the artists involved, for example. But in these two examples, we are still in the descriptive dimension of the document. Because these two examples that I gave, either the short trailer or the full-length document, they are descriptive because they are like ends in themselves. They sort of close a cycle. Performativity begins precisely with the eventualization of the document, that is to say, in considering what the document does to the subjects, or what it makes subjects doing from it. And again, Dennis Atkinson, he would name these documents as pedagogical events based on the idea of event by Alain Badiou, because they trigger, these documents trigger the emergence of a pedagogical subject, that is a subject yet to come. It is a subject becoming, a subject as learner, someone that speaks and acts not from fixed position, but someone that is still in process, still between some points and another point, someone on the way. So, either as a feedback to artists during the process of creation, or as the display of methodology to discuss with students, the document makes doing, or the document performs, since from it an autonomous object, from the documented object. So either as feedback to artists during the process of creation, or as a display of methodology to discuss with students, the document makes doing, or the document performs, since from it, as an autonomous object from the documented object, rereadings and alternative views are provided. So the video of the process of this making of this Gelha has already enabled transformative effects for learners and teachers in Porto also, because it allows telling something about the process of an art making that depends mostly on individual training and oral direction. But still, the autonomy of the document that enables performativity, rather than being a liberation from the original object, this idea of autonomy must be regarded in similar terms of that of the commentary that Michel Foucault speaks of in his The Order of Discourse. And this idea of the commentary as a second text aims to continuously produce new discourses about the first text, or about the first object of art, the original object of art, that in this case would be the artistic piece. And the novelty, according to Foucault, resides in the event that is each comeback of the first text. So, concerning this idea of the commentary of the documentary, or the commentary of the do commentary, the evoked performativity of documentation largely resides in the way it elaborates a discourse on the artistic practice, and through this becomes artistic research. And the third and last premise is that a visual narrative can become artistic research. The discourse on the artistic practice, which is the commentary, as I was saying, is the process that goes from documenting to the documentary. In this video, I intend to construct a narrative with my commentary on what I have experienced during the artist residency that I have done together with Christina, Gaby, and Peter. So the narrative, of course, should not hinder the truth of events. But as an autonomous object, it also becomes a space where I can, through video, tell a story in order to make knowledgeable a process otherwise opaque. And still, this doesn't mean that I will turn it transparent or crystal clear or eliminate it, because it is always subjective, as I have started to say. So telling a story is a significant part of artistic practice, and since new modes of narration have emerged with remakes and reproduction techniques that spread out in visual culture since the 90s, and we did a non-linear notion of time, for example. Since these modes of narration have emerged, the idea of a narrative, of a documentary, no longer needs to be chronological as well, nor balanced, nor plausible. So in the video we brought here, for example, we didn't follow a chronology of events on purpose, since we were mostly guided by the inquiry of what is it that is going on and how can I share it with others. So it is mostly guided by this idea rather than by the sequence of occurrences as they happened. It did not even make sense to cope with that chronology since the performers during rehearsals were doing different things at the same time. And we stopped doing some exercise to record or to stage, for example, the photography of Peter as a dead man, and then Peter and Gaby continued rehearsing the improvised movement, and then we stopped to go around the city and took out Gaby being the old woman and doing the stroll around the city. So it was all very, how do you say, interleaved and mixed. And this is why I also wanted to, for example, you have that shot of Gaby sighing in the end of the sequence. It was not her last movement, but I wanted to highlight the tiresome and the exhausting that was the process of memorizing all that improvised movements. And this is also the reason why you have, for example, Christina complaining that Leonardo didn't send the files, or complaining that she cannot cope with technology. So this is all part of a tiresome process of preparing a final piece and rehearsing in the way that they did it. So I decided to focus on aspects that seem relevant for the purpose of making an artistic project and artistic research project by sharing the process of making and turning it into a reflexive piece through documentation. So being aware of your own interest in the work and purpose of the document, of course, helps to decide which editing is the best for the process of documentary making. And furthermore, you can also consider that the skills and aesthetic concern of the documenter might or not give the means to an autonomous artistic piece of its own. Sort of in a way of translating, in Benjamin's sense of translation, for example, from a first stance into what is another artistic piece. So from one artistic piece into another. So in this case, the audience of the artistic research could also include artists, researchers, teachers, and students alike. Of course, we know that this is not yet very complex. We are just enunciating some premises that we like to develop further in terms of what documentation represents in the process of turning an artistic piece into a valid object into the community of research, for example, if you like. But we wanted to bring it here because this exercise of thinking and speaking about what we do also helps us to reflect on our work, of course. And for the moment, we are also committed to build an archive of the Gelkas. We already have it online, but only with the artistic part of it. So with the final pieces, with photographies of the final pieces, with poster advertisements. But we will add slowly all the reflexive or research-like materials as well and make it accessible so everyone that can, share and maybe start a dialogue on what terms happen to research in this way. So thank you very much.
I guess if I could start off with a question. I'm curious from four of you, in light of what John was presenting at the beginning, like how do you understand your work in terms of the variety of types of arts research?
I was just saying, and when I think of, I'm very, very affected by this idea of, if you think how can an artistic piece become research? So there is something that we, as John was saying, that we take a priori that artistic making part isn't exact, as I don't know, research. So something in the middle happens, so we are all concerned, I think, in trying to figure out what is it that turns something, but without changing it, actually. So probably there is something that occurs in parallel, something that we can add to that first piece or to that first artistic happening or artistic stance that in certain contexts also allow that this piece becomes what we call research. But from my personal view, it isn't really something that changed in the process of making as an artist. So it's not something that occurs in the level of the essence of the work, if you want. So it's something that's occurs out of the object of art. And by object, I mean performance, dance, whatever you want to say. So in this case, or talking generally, saying it better, yeah, I think that it's about like changing the subjectivity of the artist. So the artist still does what it usually does, but he might want to add some insights, or actually it's about being available to start dialogue with other people and about what he or she does mm-hmm. when he's just doing art.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it's a little bit different when you can talk about artistic research, and that's one thing. And then if you talk about arts education research, and arts education is another thing. But that, what we tried here also, it was to confront or to put into the same stage the artistic practices and the educational practices, and how these can be confronted and not solved in terms of a kind of a solution that translates the artistic to the educational field, but how can you, in artistic and arts education research and practices, how can you live with the tensions of art and the tensions of education? It's not artistic research that is the problem here, but is how to live with these tensions, not trying to solve them, not trying to find the kind of recipes to transport to the classroom, but how can, for instance, the ways of doing thinking and the processes of the artist, how can it travel to the classroom and start changing what is happening in terms of the educational settings, but not in this one way of translating what art is to some educational purposes. It's how to maintain this tension alive, that arts education is not the art, it's not the education, is a space that lives within as a kind of a gap between these two worlds of art and education, I think, mm-hmm. and how to maintain this alive.
Yeah, I feel like that's the same tension, or similar, but in different fields. We, both in John's talk and the first talk that you guys gave, there was a lot of concern about commodification and being co-opted by the people we're working around and against. And I find that it's hard to exist as an artist researcher that's completely autonomous. Like, I have to clarify with my scientists a lot, I'm not your illustrator, I'm an interested collaborator. However, I don't think it's a bad thing that my work is advocacy. Like, I think that's a vital part of my work, but I can do that while still existing as my own thing and not subservient to, you know, whatever capitalist system that you're talking about.
I think the key is always, recently I've been researching, there's actually a strange parallels between this kind of discourse and also theology, believe it or not. I'm reading at the moment a lot of Paul Tillich, who, as you know, you might know this, he talks a lot about the God beyond God, and the God beyond the God of theology. And actually it goes back to hermeneutics in terms of the interpretation. I mean, hermeneutics has always been the interpretation of text, but we seem to kind of imply that interpretation, or we forget, and Gadamer reminds us that that's not the case. That interpretation is something to do with us being, something becomes the object of, a subjective kind of endeavor. But actually, interpretation or the engagement of several sort of, you know, means, if you like, or several spheres, is the possibility of an intersubjective relationship. And the intersubjective relationship means that if we're dealing with art and education, it does not mean that education becomes the object of art, or art becomes the object of education, likewise with research. But rather, actually, that they are intersubjectively linked. The idea, I mean, I mentioned Paul Tillich because it's interesting, is that if you think about it in the way we have been, and, you know, I talk a lot about unlearning, partly because there's a book coming out, which I wrote about unlearning, is there is all one of the models about what we unlearn, is how to unlearn the notion of the idea of a God as the bloke upstairs. Partly because, and Tillich argues this, that if God suddenly we become the objects of God, or God becomes our object, then the whole project fails in terms of theological argument, which he puts, because actually that means that there's that kind of relationship between these two entities, these two ideas, whatever you want to call them, fails. It collapses because it becomes a form of either tyranny or idolatry. So, I mean, and if you think about the arts and aesthetics has been embroiled in this kind of theological argument in terms of how we need to unlearn a lot about what we've been kind of taught in terms of the arts, but also in terms of research as well, because research has become a metric for other than research. And that's the problem. So if there is a possibility of an intersubjective, these are two subjects or several subjects which are intersubjectively, but still autonomous, they still have their own autonomous relationship, then that becomes interesting. If it becomes a heteronomous relationship, where one dictates what the other one should be doing, whichever way you look at it, then there's a problem. And I think that's the big problem we have in academia, because we're trying to justify the arts to exist within universities. Often, we keep saying, oh, look, the arts could bring you a lot of money. I have to do it myself, by the way, in my own role as the director of the arts division. When I'm talking to other deans, I keep telling them, look, you know, I mean, if you think about the arts, these festivals bring a lot of money to the community, blah, blah, blah. I'd like to call it an honest lie, because it's not untrue, but it's not exactly true of what I intend to do. I'm saying it because we have to, and this is how we justify the arts, you know. I mean, you have people running big agencies in the arts, and we often ask them, why on earth do you have to kind of justify the arts for their economic value? And I've been hearing someone saying this last week, actually. She said, well, actually, it's just a way in. I'd like to call it an honest lie, because it is lying, because actually it's not true that we want the arts just to, you know, serve the economy. But actually, we want to have a place for the arts because of their autonomous potential. So, I mean, that's the kind of thing. And it is this tension that we have to live in, and, you know, you can call it whatever you like.
Questions, thoughts from anyone?
So I mean, that's a great starting point for what I've been thinking about, is that, like, you guys are all operating within university contexts, and so the relationship of this kind of practice to institutions can always be like a little odd, because the standard for art practice is continual flux, is continual change, is continual unlearning, is all of those ing words, you know, whereas the state of the institution is self-preservation. And is ossification. And so do you have, like, you kind of shared one strategy for negotiating that. I'm wondering if other people have, like, strategies for how you negotiate that that kind of system of patronage, but then, like, resistance as well.
We've been going on for 10 years now. One thing.
Well, it's a difficult thing, actually, because we keep in that place of always justifying why the arts are important in a university that sees itself as a pluralist place. So it's always difficult. Right now in Portugal we are having that discussion on what kind of metrics can we apply to arts research. And one thing that is happening is that we are being invited to participate in this discussion, and I think that it seems a very simple thing, but it was actually something that was difficult to happen, because the metrics were always being thought from an external place. So now we are participating in the discussions. Of course, you are always trying to explain things that doesn't have to be explained, because then you are just making things that are complex seem very, very simple. Well, I don't have any kind of strategies, but I think that it is important when you are called to the discussion I think that we have a role here in trying to produce a discourse from within. Actually, it is like artistic research itself. Artistic research is not research about the heart, so the metrics must be also produced from within, from the persons that are doing artistic research, I think, and that's a step that I think that we gave in last years. It's to participate in the discussion of what can artistic research be and how can it be assessed, I think.
I think that's very interesting, that idea of a discourse from within. Because we tend to look at it in a more valuable way, because it comes from within. It's not an outsider that comes and speaks instead of us about what we are doing. And so it was in this sense of a certain hopefulness that in 2015 there was the first research pavilion in Venice Biennale. And at that time I was studying, I was doing my PhD in artistic research, exactly trying to understand what is this discursivity about artistic research. And I was just, whoa, there will be a research pavilion. So this, at last, this means that artists are really gaining a position within the art world, because it is part of Venice Biennale. So it's not just a small art exhibition, it's the Venice Biennale. And what happened that year until, well, then again in 2000, 2 years later, right? The difference, when you ask the curators of that research pavilion, what is the difference of that research pavilion of a regular, the difference between that and a regular art exhibition, it just answers that the difference is that the research exhibition has more discursive moments. So what he meant, after all, is that the research pavilion was full and filled with roundtables, seminars, these formats that are usual of the academy. But in itself, the exhibition continued to be a regular exhibition. So we also have to ask, what does it mean to have a discourse from within when we within tend to adapt and to adopt formats that are used by the institution that we want to somehow shake and somehow transform. So in a way, things tend also or might also become similar to the discourses that are from outside in a certain way, if we don't take this seriously as a discussion or as a debate.
It's funny, I'm like working almost in the opposite way, where you're speaking on the way that arts research is happening in art spaces. The way that I exist is I enter science spaces. I go to lectures, I draw, I let people see, they come up and talk to me. I'm incredibly active on biology Twitter, which is apparently where all the scientists hang out. And so I here on campus, I run the Image Lab, which is a very public-facing space in our science outreach building here. And so I just make myself present and cold call researchers I want to work with and sort of push myself into those spaces.
Hi, thank you for your lecture. This would be maybe a broader question, but since I haven't lived in Portugal for many years now, but I know a little bit what's going on there, you know, in conversation with what's going on in a lot of European countries that, of course, have enforced somehow the PhD in the arts. And so you guys, I'm sure you are aware that in North America, it's a very different situation. Artists don't teach in academia having a PhD normally. And you have very few institutions that actually offer a PhD in arts. How do you think, in terms of interesting, healthy conversation, what's happening, internally in Europe, conversation between Portugal and other countries and other, sort of exchange in terms of academia, and what kind of conversation is happening between you guys as researchers and people here in the few institutions that are offering a PhD in art?
Well, at the Faculty of Fine Arts, actually, we have two PhDs.
Okay.
One of the PhDs is in arts, is a practical PhD, and the other one is a PhD in arts education, which is quite different from the arts PhD. I think that in terms of conversations, I think that we have some relations with particularly with Nordic countries, and maybe the models that we are trying in a way to import to the Faculty of Fine Arts come from the Nordic, but it's basically through personal relations that are developed more than a serious work that the faculty is doing in terms of thinking what a PhD in arts can mean in terms of establishing the field itself, I think, because I think we have that obligation. If we are a faculty that is offering a PhD in the arts, I think we have to produce a discourse and arguments that make this PhD different from other PhD in humanities or arts education. But I think that we need more dialogue, and I think because we are not yet prepared to really think what a PhD in arts can mean in terms of the construction of the epistemological field of research in the arts itself.
Because from my quick observation, I realized that there is a lot of tension and the intersections, sometimes they match, sometimes they don't, between a lot of institutions in Europe.
Yeah.
So I believe there is a lot of interesting conversation, but also disagreement on the models that, you know, are proposed for.
Yeah.
Here in the US, I don't know if this is going to catch up. I don't know how many institutions offer PhD in arts, but we'll see how that falls.
I think in the United States, we have done a lot through by stealth.
Mm.
So for example, when I was teaching scholars at Columbia University in the art department, the art education department, we did a lot, but I mean through art education. So there was a need in the college teaching of art, which actually accepted students who have either an MFA or who have a very active practice. They don't necessarily have to be teachers, but the aim was for them to think about how when they start teaching in universities, or some of them have already been because they have MFAs, how they kind of articulate their doctorate, partly because there was myself and another colleague, Graham Sullivan, who actually is very well known for his work on arts research, that we did a lot, we pushed the envelope, as they say here, in terms of how we bring in practice within that, but within the regulations of the university itself, which is quite interesting. However, having said that, having supervised and, you know, been involved in defenses in Porto, actually, I found not dissimilar situations in terms of the tensions. I mean, the kind of interesting tension happens in the defense when you have examiners, actually. And you have to be careful what sort of kind of, because if it slants towards the negative side of things, how people come in with a critical edge onto the PhD, they don't believe it. You have a very kind of problematic situation. But I mean, the discussions that emerge even in the defense is quite, reflects actually the general tenor. In Britain, where I also supervise, both in art schools, but also in education, art education schools, I found that, to my surprise, that in certain art schools where I taught it would be much more free, it wasn't. And I found that actually it's the practitioners who are creating problems sometimes and making objections of the term of, you know, they don't accept arts practice as a form of research, rather than some of the other people who come from a combination of theory and practice like myself. But that's an interesting one. And also, if you think about the PhD in Britain, I mean, there was a point where I used to belong to very strongly believe in the PhD in practice, but now I'm starting to think whether there should be like the music model in America, where you have a DMA, which is Doctor of Music Art, and then you have a PhD, which has to do with musicology and music history and stuff, and then you also have an EdD, which has to do with music education. In art, we don't have the FA, which would move on from an MFA, which would actually probably, in and of itself, kind of focus on the practice. But as someone told me, a British colleague actually who's now working in America, she told me that boat has sailed. So strictly speaking, we are with the PhDs now, and we need to think really seriously of how to push the envelope of the PhD in arts practice. But again, where they are established, both in Europe, I mean, I don't have a direct experience of other European colleagues, but I know that in Holland, for example, the Netherlands, they have different models. But in Britain, they have very different models. You can have a big dissertation and a body of work. You have a huge body of work and a very small dissertation. Or you can have two. I mean, the forms of examining are very different. Although they all conform to a set of principles which have been positioned in Bologna of what a doctoral level sort of research should be. Which actually goes into the danger which Katharina was talking about, where you end up playing the game too much. So there is an element of risk here in terms of what the doctorate should be or how we should be doing it. So it's not actually a panacea, it's not a solution, but it's part of the process. So I don't know what was going to happen in 10 years' time, but definitely I think the idea of bringing the arts and having them in the university have definitely catalyzed a lot of discussion in terms of what research is. And I can tell you that our best allies have always been scientists, the natural scientists, because they see in their experimental kind of approach to their own work very similarities of what we do. So they take the risks, they know that they're not going to expect. I mean, I personally think the biggest problem is the closeness to the social scientists, especially some of the empiricists. I mean, in education, that's a huge, huge risk because you're dealing with positivists and empiricists who actually always want results the way they understand them. So that's the worst thing. When you're working with scientists, you have a very different kind of connection with them. So it varies. But I mean, definitely, you know, it's becoming a big, big thing in itself. If you look at how many books are being published on arts research and what they mean by it, which means everything and nothing, so it is kind of a... And this is why we're doing these Agons, by the way, to try to you know, have the final conversation.
All right, okay. Well, thank you so much for talking.
Thank you.
This was a great conversation.
Thank you, everyone, for coming.